Albright is superior to lamotrigine and topiramate in patients with generalized epilepsy. So the introduction of newer anti-seizure medications are brivaracetam, perampanel, cannabidiol, and cenobamate, everolimus, and fenfluramine. We'll go one by one. Compared with levetiracetam, brivaracetam has a higher affinity for the synaptic vesicle. It is found to be superior to other drugs in focal epilepsy. The only limitation is lack of efficacy when added to levetiracetam because of the competition between the two drugs for the SV2A binding site. And it has gotten the advantage over levetiracetam because it is less likely to cause irritability and other behavioral disturbances. Perampanel is a AMPA receptor antagonist used in generalized tonic-clonic seizures. It is the cerebellum.
Not moving, sir.
I think allow him to continue. No wastage of time. Go on continuing. Please continue.
Now it is moving, sir.
The cenobamate is a recently approved drug for focal seizures. It's a carbamate derivative, acts by GABA receptor modulation and decreases the excitatory sodium currents. All other drugs are only orphan indications. Cannabidiol is approved for Dravet's syndrome, gestalt, and tuberous sclerosis. Fenfluramine is for the Dravet seizure. Everolimus is approved for tuberous sclerosis seizures. Cannabidiol, as all of us know, from the cannabis plant, it acts on multiple targets. One, antagonism of G protein coupled receptor 55, and the positive allosteric modulation GABA receptor, TRP1. That is desensitization of transient receptor potential of vanilloid type 1 channels. There are 10 mg per kg per day and 20 mg per kg per day doses available, but with better safety and tolerability, we use 10 mg per kg per day dose. Fenfluramine, which was used as appetite suppressant in 1960s, 1997, it was withdrawn due to cardiac valvulopathy and pulmonary hypertension. So prior to withdrawal from the market, we found there's improvement in seizure control in Dravet syndrome. So it acts by disrupting the vesicle storage of serotonin and inhibiting its reuptake from synapse and positive modulation of sigma 1 receptor. So data suggests that fenfluramine may be also useful in Lennox-Gastaut syndrome. The doses used for seizure protection are generally lower than which was originally used for appetite suppression. So now we don't see any cardiovascular side effects. The dose is 20 to 30 mg per kg per day. Everolimus is an inhibitor of mTOR, that is mammalian target rapamycin, used in the treatment of tuberous sclerosis associated with seizures. Padcevonil has presynaptic SV2 receptors like brivaracetam. So the advances in the epilepsy treatment can be achieved by improving the pharmaceutical formulation of already available medications. Recently, we have diazepam rectal gel intranasal midazolam, which are well accepted by patient caregivers, and also used for therapy before the patient reaches the hospital. So what are the technological tools in the management of epilepsy? IT-based application, smartphones to record seizures in the OP setting, and the internet services such as distant education and telemedicine. Smartphone application assists people with treatment, medication adherence, healthcare communication, seizure tracking. And also the app-based individual patient characteristic was found to be associated with improved seizure outcome. The technology will increasingly assist patients in monitoring response to treatment through seizure detection devices. The precision therapies, elucidation of an epileptic genetic mutation which permits to establish functional abnormality, a response for seizures in the affected individuals. And it is to identify the precision therapy medication that may be able to correct such abnormality. For example, utilization of ketogenic diet to control seizures with glucose transport type 1 deficiency syndrome and pyridoxine in cases of pyridoxine dependent epilepsy. Avoid anti-seizure medication aggravate. For example, administration of sodium channel blocking drugs in SE1A related DS. Then also using medications already available in the market for other indication. For example, memantine used to treat epileptic encephalopathy, which is caused by GRIN2M mutation of NMDA receptors. So what is drug repurposing? So it is nothing but precision treatments targeting the mechanism responsible for epilepsy in individuals with gene mutation may involve use of drugs previously approved for other indications. This process is known as drug repurposing. Example, the mammalian target of rapamycin inhibitor, the near anti-epileptic, is everolimus, which is used in the treatment of tuberous sclerosis complex with seizure. What is this biomarker guided therapies? It is based on genetic, molecular, cellular, and electrophysiological measures. The biomarkers such as the HLA-B15 to identify individuals at high risk of coronary induced serious cutaneous side reactions. There are novel drugs and the search for disease modifying therapies. So this is the list of drugs which are under investigation in clinical development potential treatment for epilepsy. A wide variety of drugs have been found to possess both anti-epileptic and neuroprotective activity. For example, the cannabinoids, melatonin, erythropoietin, and vitamins, as well as the drugs which are approved for other indications like metformin, statin, and ceftriaxone, etc. So what are the advances in epilepsy surgery? So despite the advances in imaging and the neurological surgical experience, the outcome of seizure freedom in epilepsy surgery have not changed over the last 20 years. So currently 20-40% of patients with epilepsy are considered refractory to medical treatment, in which less than 50% of these candidates for focal receptive surgery, in which the long-term seizure freedom, which ranges from only 30-60%, depending on the operation. So what are the three broad direction of advances? The first and foremost is refinement of the epileptic zone based on advanced pre-surgical evaluation in the form of intracranial EEG monitoring, which gives better patient selection for the cortical resections. The next, neuroablative surgical methods to achieve targeted cortical or subcortical resection. The third and the last is neuromodulation therapies. Those who are not candidates for resective epilepsy surgery, because the epilepsy arises from eloquent cortex like speech area, which is multifocal or generalized. So what is the advances in imaging and epilepsy zone? All of us know the non-routine MR sequences and voxel-based morphometric analysis, functional MRI with EEG and 3D imaging. The neuroablative procedures are four. One is radio frequency thermocoagulation, MR guided focused ultrasound, laser ablation, and stereotactic radio surgery. The radio frequency thermocoagulation is well tolerated and doesn't require general anesthesia. The only disadvantage is no real-time feedback on the lesion process, and there is a theoretical risk to surrounding structures, but it is so suited to patients where the conventional surgery is contraindicated, or if you think it is too high risk, then we can do this, especially with deep lesions like heterotopic nodules. MR-guided focused ultrasound, it's a delivering high doses of transcranial ultrasound energy to a discrete intracranial focal point. So we need to create a craniectomy window prior to this treatment to prevent the defocusing effect of the skull. So the treatment can be administered as an OP basis. There is risk of inadvertent heating of the skull base and critical structures such as cranial nerves. This is the disadvantage. Laser ablation can be achieved. Thermal therapy. It's a more precise than RF thermocoagulation. Avoid heating the skull base is seen in ultrasound ablation. The recent study described the use in focal epilepsy, which includes hippocampal sclerosis and hypothalamic hamartomas. Stereotactic radiosurgery is nothing but we use focused ionizing radiation to target deep-seated lesions, sparing damage to the normal surrounding tissue, mostly used in cyber knives such as gamma knife surgery. The advantage is deep-seated multiple lesions can be treated without any surgical approach. The disadvantage is, as usual, collateral tissue injury and late onset secondary malignancies. And current interest is centered mainly on treatment of the hippocampal sclerosis and hypothalamic hamartoma. Then next is the neuromodulation. It is nothing but stimulation of cell population either through cranial nerve or through an implanted electrode. We have two primary categories of neuromodulation devices. One is open loop and a closed loop device. The open loop are non-responsive devices where the stimulation is pre-programmed, therefore, which is independent of the brain state, whereas the closed loop are responsive devices where the detection and stimulation component depends on detection of a specific brain state. For example, the onset of ictal event in epileptics. So this picture shows the open loop, which is pre-programmed, and the closed loop, which is not pre-programmed. Open loop neuromodulation, we have three stimulations, vagal nerve, deep brain stimulation, and trigeminal nerve stimulation. The vagal nerve stimulation device comprises of a pulse generator in the left chest with a lead with attachment that wrap around the left vagus nerve. It acts by electrical stimulation to the brain with non-specifically inhibiting epileptogenesis. It's a well-established palliative treatment for the epilepsy in the patients who are not candidates for resective surgery. Deep brain stimulation acts by interrupting the propagation of seizure activity or by increasing the overall seizure threshold. The target, which is centered in and around the papi circuit. So DBS target the anterior thalamus was approved for drug refractory epilepsy in 2017. So these are the targets. One is anterior nucleus of thalamus, cerebellum, thalamus, hippocampus, and other areas. Trigeminal nerve stimulation approved in 2013. The electrodes are designed to prove electrical stimulation to the supraorbital branches of the trigeminal nerves. It is similar to vagal nerve stimulation as it involves the widespread stimulation of brain nuclei from an afferent cranial nerve. Like vagal nerve stimulation, the mechanism of action is not well understood, but it is thought to involve the deactivation of the nucleus, solitary tract, and locus ceruleus. The closed loop neuromodulation, which is responsive.
So you have 2 minutes to wind up.
Yeah. The closed loop stimulation for epilepsy was formally introduced in 2004 with neurostimulation in 2012, which was approved in FDA, which is used in patients with the medically refractory partial onset seizures arising from up to 2 foci. It's a closed loop stimulation. This picture shows the depth electrode in the right hippocampus and the subdural grid over the inferior surface of the temporal lobe. So the clinical utility of closed loop neuromodulation is the therapy for which strong electrophysiological evidence of network exists. So it has got a role in neocortical epilepsy and mesial temporal lobe epilepsy. Closed loop local drug delivery, where the localized intracerebral delivery of anti-epileptic drug can improve the efficacy of treatment of epilepsy without any systemic side effects because it is directly delivering the anti-epileptic drugs. The most promising of these is subdural hybrid neuroprosthesis described by Ludwig. The safety and efficacy is currently being investigated in animal models. I conclude my talk in this with this slide. Despite the fact the second generation anti-seizure medication have not reduced the burden of pharmacoresistance, the advances in the drug treatment of seizure is continue to be made. The advances result mostly from the introduction of newer medicines and innovative formulations. The further advances, mainly technological tools for distance education, telemedicine, and patient empowerment, which is possible by self-management with the smartphones. For patients undergoing open surgery, the improving outcomes depend on stepwise refinement of current methodology with advances in imaging also in epilepsy. For patients who are currently not candidates for open surgery, there is increased delivery of treatment options by minimally invasive techniques, either neuromodulatory or neuroablative in nature, is likely to occur in the future. Thank you. Thank you for the patient hearing. Thank you.
Thank you.